F was down, the displacement D was also down, and so we know exactly what this becomes. It becomes mg for our force, D going down for the displacement. The angle between those is 0 degrees, cosine of 0 degrees is 1, and so we get a work of m times g times d, okay, where d is some positive number. This is the work that gravity did. It is a number that is positive. It's greater than zero because the force and the displacement are in the same direction. All right, but how do we put that in terms of y, this variable y that we said is the height above the Earth? Well, if I look at D, I can see that that is actually going to be the negative of delta y, right? Yf is down here, that's going to be a small number. Yi is up there, that's going to be a big number. So that delta y would be a negative number, and so I have to add another negative sign right there. But that negative sign can come out in front, and we can write it minus mg delta y, where that y, that delta y, is y final minus y initial. And that should be clear why we had to put that negative sign there, because this stuff in parentheses here, that's going to be a negative number, right? Y final is smaller than y initial, so that will be a negative number. We have to add another negative to make sure it's a positive number. But now we can work that negative right on through. Mg y initial minus y final. And that is still a number that is positive, which is good. Okay, this is the work due to gravity. Now, let's do the analogy between this gravitational problem and an electric field problem. So, let's ask the following question before we do that. Let's say I have a whole bunch of charge that is sitting here on this plate. And now I take another plate and I put it right here and I give it a whole bunch of negative charge. In the region in between those two, is there an electric field? What do you guys think? Is there an electric field in there? Yes. Why? Because electric fields leave positive charges and end up on negative charges. So there has to be some sort of field that is pointing in that direction, okay? It's everywhere inside, but we're just gonna draw one for simplicity. If I put a particle in there, let's say I put a positive charge right there. Is that positive charge gonna feel a force on it? Absolutely, right? We know what it's going to do. Positive charges are repelled by positive charges and are attractive to negative charges. Positive charges follow lines of E. And so there's going to be a force on this positive charge, F, which is equal to Q times E. If it's positive charge, it goes with the field. If it's a negative charge, it goes opposite the field. Okay, but that positive charge that heads down in that direction, we can say, oh, that just moved a distance d. And let's use the same picture that we just had with gravity. Let's say that we're going to measure y going up from the bottom. This is like our surface of the Earth. And now we started up here at y initial, we end down there at y final. Okay, positive charge going to move downward. And let's calculate the work done by this electric field E. before the work was done by the gravitational field, but now it's going to be due to this electric field E. All right, we can do that. We've got work equals F D cosine theta. In this case, the force is just Q times E. The distance is D. The theta is again 0 degrees. Electric field is down, charge moves down, everything's in the same direction, so the angle between those is 0, and cosine of 0 is, of course, 1. All right, so we get the work is just equal to QE times D. It looks very similar to what we had before, right? In gravity, we had work was equal to mg times d. So everything that we just did, we can take advantage of and write this out as the following. QED is what? Well, that is a positive number. Q is a positive number. E, D are in the same direction. These are magnitudes in this equation, and so this is a positive number, just like we had with the gravity. All right, but we know what D is. Just like we had before, it's going to be negative delta Y, because YF is going to be smaller than Y initial. So this is minus QE delta Y, or minus QE times Y final minus Y initial. That number smaller than 1, that number is smaller than yi, and so that thing is negative. The negative sign out in front makes sure that this is still a positive number, so we're happy. But now, again, we can distribute the negative sign and write it as qey initial minus qey final. All right, let's rewrite some of that over here. We've got W equals, and let's multiply this out. We've got QEY initial minus QEY final. And now let's pull out the Q from both of those and write it like this. Q times EY initial minus EY final. And at this point, we're going to make the key substitution, which is the following. This thing we're calling V sub I. This thing we are calling V sub F. And this V is our electric potential. So this becomes Q times negative delta V, or W equals negative Q delta V. This substitution that happened right here, we introduced the electric potential V. Okay, this is not speed. Okay, this is a new term, electric potential. And what we said was, we must have VI is just equal to E times YI. And we must have VF is equal to E times YF. And so if we put these things together, what can we say? Delta V is just VF minus VI. But that is EYF minus EYI. The E is common, and so this becomes EYF minus YI. And YF minus YI is the same as negative D. And so there is a relationship between V, the electric potential, and E, and it's just this. The change in the potential is negative E times D. Okay, any questions up to this point? This was a little bit heavy on the derivation, but I wanted to make sure you understood where this stuff comes from. It's very similar to what we did in gravity. We're just talking about a new potential. Now it's the electric potential. So V is the electric potential, and it has units that you are familiar with. This electric potential V has units of volts. Okay, that's the SI unit for electric potential V. W, which was work, we said is equal to negative Q delta V. And Q is, of course, charge. So that has units of coulombs. Volts is the SI unit. And so a coulomb volt is also energy, right? Work has the same units as energy. But Q, you don't have to write in coulombs. There's another way to write it, which is E times V. And this is electron volts. Okay. The SI unit is coulombs times volts, but we often talk about electron volts, and you've probably heard electron volts before, particularly in your chemistry classes, when they talk about what's the ionization energy of a certain atom, they will say, oh, it is 6 electron volts or 13.6 electron volts. That is a unit of energy. That says how much energy do you have to apply to the system to strip the electron off. So one electron volt means the following. The energy acquired by an electron accelerating through 1 volt. Okay, that's what one electron volt means. You're going to take the electron, you're going to accelerate it through a potential difference of 1 volt. That's how much energy it requires. It acquires 1 electron volt. Okay, so there's all this relationship between energy and electric field and electric potential V, and those relationships we can take advantage of. So let's take a look at one of your homework problems. And this is, I believe it's number 17.05. Okay, and let's take a look and see if we can make some sense of that. Okay, so the problem says an electron moves between plate A and B. And it gets energy when it does that. It gets kinetic energy, delta K, of 6.6 times 10 to the minus 16 joules. This is how much energy the electron acquires when it moves between those two plates. And we need to find delta V of the plates. Okay. We need to find the potential difference in those two plates. All right, so first off, let's see if we can just draw a picture of this thing. Okay, plate A is right there. Plate B is right there. I'm going to put an electron at plate A, and it's going to accelerate towards plate B, and it's going to pick up energy, and it's picking up 6.6 times 10 to the minus 16 joules of energy. So We need to find delta V of the plates. Let's ask a question off the bat. This plate has some charge on it, and this plate has some charge on it. Does this plate over here have positive charge on it or negative charge on it? What do you guys think? Plate A, is it full of positive charge or is it full of negative charge? Well, the electron is going to move away from it. Is the electron positively charged or negatively charged? The electron is negatively charged, right? Negative 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. So if this electron is a little negative charge, what must be on plate A? Negative charge. Exactly right. Likes repel. There must be a whole bunch of negative charge on that plate to push that electron away. And therefore, the other plate has got to be filled with positive charge because that's going to pull the electron in. Okay. All right. How do we do this? Well, what we said was any work in the system is Q delta V, and all of that work is going to go into changing the kinetic energy of the electron. And so we can write down a very simple relationship here. Delta K is just Q delta V. That doesn't look too bad. Let's see if it makes sense. Change in kinetic energy. It's got to be equal to the work that goes into it. And we're not worried about signs here. We'll worry about that in part B. So we put some magnitudes on that thing, and therefore we don't have to worry about signs here. Okay? All right. Delta K equals Q delta V. We're solving for delta V. So delta V equals change in kinetic energy divided by Q. We know this number. Delta K is 6.6 times 10 to the minus 16 joules. We know what Q is because it's one electron. And again, we're not worrying about signs here, so we'll just put in the magnitude. 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. Those are SI units. The units of V are volts or joules per coulomb. And in fact, 1 volt equals 1 joule per coulomb. Okay, so now we can plug in all these numbers, right? Delta V, I'll approximate it here. If you want to punch into your calculator, you can try it. I get 6.6 over 1.6, and I have a 10 to the minus 16, I have a 10 to the minus 19 in the denominator, so that gets me a 10 to the 3. 6.6 over 1.6 is, that's got to be pretty close to 4. I'm going to say that's about 4, and we have a 10 to the 3. And did anybody punch it into their calculator and get a real number there?
4.1 times 10 to the
3. Okay, 4.1 times 10 to the 3, and the units are joules per coulomb or volts, which you can just write with a capital V when you plug it in to your homework. 4.1 times 10 to the 3 volts. Okay? The second part of that is related to the very first thing that we did. Which of these is at higher potential? The one that is at higher potential is the one with the positive charge. And so the potential here at plate B is going to be bigger than the potential at plate A. VB is greater than VA. And so this is a good exercise when you're doing these problems. Go back to a picture, put in a charge, see if you can figure out where the other charges must be. And to do that, all you need to remember is likes repel, opposites attract. Okay, questions on this one? Everybody okay? Okay, potential that we just talked about is a lot like altitude, right? We made the analogy between gravity and electric potential. And in gravity, it was how high you were above the Earth. And so when you think about a map, a lot of times if you're looking at a topological map, it shows you altitude lines. It shows you where the mountains are, and then it shows you altitude lines around those mountains. Well, we can do the same thing for electric potential lines, and those things are called equipotential surfaces. So, before we do that, we need to know a little something about the potential of a point charge. Okay? A point charge has a potential that looks like the following. V is equal to KQ over R. Now this we're not gonna prove to you. You can do it when you get to calculus, and you can use some calculus to show how this all works. But this is just a definition. You could just accept it as a definition. What it means is if I have a point charge, Q, sitting right there, and I'm looking for the potential here, a distance R away, the potential is equal to KQ over R. So if it's a positive charge, then we have a positive potential. And that potential is going to drop off as a function of R, how far away from the charge you are. So it'll look like that. Positive charge, and therefore V equals KQ over R. And we'll put the Q in magnitudes there, because if it's a negative charge, then the potential becomes negative. And so now it looks like this. That's a minus Q. V is equal to minus KQ over R. So as you go further away from a point charge, the potential drops off. And in fact, if you go all the way out to infinity, the potential goes to zero. Okay? R goes to infinity, it's in the denominator, and so the potential would go to zero. So R equals infinity is our reference point. That's where potential is equal to zero. But let's say we do the following question. We just showed you what the potential is here, V. It's KQ over R. But what about the potential here? Is that going to be the same thing? Is that going to be KQ over R? Or is that going to be negative KQ over R? What do you guys think? Well, it kind of goes back to the question of, what is this potential? Is potential a scalar or a vector? What do you guys think? Is this thing a scalar or a vector? Well, do you see any arrows anywhere? I don't see any arrows on top of anything, right? There's nothing on top of V. There's no I-hats, J-hats, or K-hats, or R-hats, or anything over here on the right side. So this is, in fact, a scalar quantity. It is not a vector. There's no direction associated with V. It's just a number. It's 100 volts. It is 1,000 volts. It's just a number. So this is not right. It's not negative KQ over R. It is, in fact, also positive KQ over R. And now by symmetry, I could put my point anywhere around this thing. And if I'm always at the same distance R away from it, then it's always going to have the exact same potential. And this is the idea with an equipotential surface. It's where the potential is always equal. It's always the exact same thing. So for a point charge, Q, I have an equipotential surface like that. And I can draw another one if I like. It's going to have a different value, but it is certainly equal all the way around. And this is like your topological map, right? If Q was the mountaintop, this would be the next elevation step down. This would be the next elevation step down from there, and so forth. But if you walk around along that dashed line, you're always at the same elevation. If you walk around these dashed lines, you're always at the same potential. The E field, of course, is always perpendicular to those. We know that E goes radially outward. And so the E field is always perpendicular to the equipotential surface. Surfaces of constant V, that's what an equipotential surface is, are always perpendicular to E. So let's take that under advisement and see if we can draw the equipotential surface for a dipole. So let's go back to our dipole for a second. And we know what a dipole looks like. It's a positive charge and then a negative charge. And now we know what the electric field looks like for a dipole. It goes like this. Okay, and you'll see these sorts of pictures again and again, particularly in your chemistry books. So this is the lines of E for the dipole. What about equipotential surfaces? Well, we said that the equipotential surfaces always have to be perpendicular to E. So if there is some equipotential surface right here, it has to start out perpendicular to that line. But the next one's a little curved, so I got to make sure I'm perpendicular to that line, and then the next one is at a different angle, and then the next one's at a different angle, and so forth. And if I do a curve like that, I am perpendicular to the lines of E everywhere. All right, but by symmetry, I can do one on the other side, right? It'll look nearly the same. That's an equipotential surface for the negative charge. But likewise, I can come right across the center here. That's an equipotential surface. And you can keep going. You can draw as many as you like. There's going to be one that looks like this. There's going to be one that looks like this. And so forth. Okay, these are all equipotential surfaces, these dashed lines. Now, what's sort of interesting about an equipotential surface is since it's perpendicular to V, particles can move along those lines without having any work done on them. Because remember, in our work equation, it was FD cosine theta. And if theta is 90 degrees, the cosine of 90 degrees is, of course, zero. So a charge can move along one of these lines without having any work done on it at all. Okay, let's try an example of calculating the potential for a slightly more complicated arrangement of charges. All right, let's draw a square. And let's say that we have the following. We have a Q1 right there, a Q2, a Q3, and a Q4. And each side here is going to be L of this square. And let's find the potential right at the center of the square. Okay, so we want to find V at the center. And we'll give you some charges here. Okay, so Q1 is in fact equal to Q2, which is equal to Q3. And those all have a value of 6 microcoulomb. And Q4 has a value of minus 3 microcoulombs. And we'll say that L is equal to 2 centimeters. All right, and we're looking for V right at the center. All right, we need to figure out how to do this. One thing that we know about electric fields is they obey the principle of superposition, right? If I have two electric fields, I can add them up as vectors. It turns out that potential also satisfies the principle of superposition. So if I want V at the center, that is just V1 plus V2 plus V3 plus V4. And we know what V is for a point charge. So V1 becomes KQ1 divided by R, where this distance here is R. V2 is KQ2 over R. V3 is KQ3 over R. And V4 is KQ4 over R. We know all the Q's. We can probably figure out what the R's are, but we also can call this thing just Q, and we'll say that that Q is equal to 6 microcoulombs, and therefore we can simplify this quite a bit. This first one just becomes KQ over R, and then we have KQ over R, and a third, and then the fourth one is the only one that's different. And so this whole thing becomes 3 KQ over R. And we can even simplify this a little bit more, right? We have 3 of those KQs. Now, let's leave it like that for now. 3 KQ over R plus KQ4 over R. Okay, we know K. We know the Qs. We need to figure out R. What is R? Well, R is the distance from the center to any one of these edges. And so if I think about a triangle right here, this side of the triangle is L over 2. This side of the triangle is L over 2. And so we have R squared equals L over 2 squared plus L over 2 squared, which is 2L squared over 4, which is L squared over 2. And so R, in fact, just becomes L over root 2. Okay, and now we have all those numbers and we can plug it in here and try it out. So let's do that. We've got a K over R out in front. And then we have 3q plus q4. And let's make some room up here and we'll plug in some of these numbers. And you might have to remind me of these numbers, but. Okay, so we said that the potential at the center was k over r, 3q plus q4. And we know that k is 8.99 times 10 to the 9. R, we just said, was L over root 2. L, we said, was 2 centimeters, so that's 0.02 meters. Divide that by root 2. Q, we said, was 6 microcoulombs, right? 3 times 6 times 10 to the minus 6. And then Q4, we said, was negative 3 microcoulombs. All right, and now we can plug in all these numbers. Why don't you guys try it in your calculator, and I'll see if I can approximate it here. So we've got 9 times 10 to the 9. We've got a 2 times 10 to the minus 2. Root 2 is about 1.4. Put that right there. And then we have 18 minus 3 is 15 times 10 to the minus 6. So let's see what we get. We get 9 times 15 is 135. So 135, that 1.4 is going to come up top. We've got a times 10 to the 3 up top. And then we still have that 2 times 10 to the minus 2 down there. And what do we get? 135 times 1.4, that's got to be about 200. And 200 divided by 2 is 100. So I have 100 there, I have 3 there, so that's a 10 to the 5. And then I have a 10 to the minus 2. So I'm going to say this has got to be around 10 to the 7. Did anybody run in their calculator and get a number?
9.53.
Okay. So the actual answer is 9.53 times 10 to the 6, which is pretty close to our guess, right? Because this is almost 10, and that would make this thing 10 to the 7. 9.53 times 10 to the 6, and we're asking about V, right? V is volts. Okay, there is 9.53 times 10 to the 6 volts at the center of this square. Now, the nice thing about potential here is it's a scalar. We don't have to worry about any direction. There was no direction associated with our geometry. It was just what's the value there determined by the distance away from the point charge. Okay, and then we just had to add them up. All right, questions about this? This would be the time to ask if you guys have any questions about what we just did. Okay, why don't we take a 5-minute break, and I'll see you guys back here in just a few. Hi guys, welcome back. We had a little technical difficulty there, so the bathroom break went a little longer than normal, but I think we're live again. We've been getting some messages, I believe, from Austin out there. Austin, how you doing? And he was asking about 1740 on the homework, okay? So 1740 is a capacitor question, and so we need to just spend a little time talking about capacitors first, and then we'll get to Austin's question. So let's talk about parallel plate capacitors. And we've been drawing these things the whole time, we just didn't know it, right? A parallel plate capacitor is just that, two parallel plates. You put a whole bunch of positive charge on one of them, you put a whole bunch of negative charge on the other. Okay, that looks really familiar, right? We just talked a lot about that. If you have positive charge on this plate and you have negative charge on this plate, there has to be an electric field in here everywhere pointing down. Now, in reality, the electric field is not uniform because when you get to the edge, the electric field lines start to curve a little bit. Okay, so this is called fringing fields, and at the edge of a parallel plate capacitor, you have curved lines to your electric field. But if the area of the plate is large compared to its separation, then everywhere in the middle, E is essentially uniform. And we'll put it in quotations, parentheses, it's nearly uniform. It's not really uniform, but it's nearly uniform. All right, so what is the value of E in there? Well, if I put a total charge plus Q on the top plate, and I put a total charge of minus Q on the bottom plate, it turns out that the E field has the following strength. This is in between the plates. And E is equal to Q over epsilon naught times A. And we don't know exactly what these things are, so let's write it out in words. Q is the charge on the top plate. Okay? You don't have to worry about the minus Q. It's assumed that every time you put plus Q on the top plate, you're going to have minus Q on the bottom plate. And when we get to circuits, we'll talk about why that is. Okay, so Q is just the charge on one of those plates. Epsilon naught is, of course, permittivity of free space, right? That is a constant. A is the area of the plate. So this is not really quite a correct picture. These things are really three-dimensional plates. It looks like that. And so the area is that. It's the cross-sectional area of the plate, of one of the plates. Okay, another way to write this is the following. This is also written as sigma over epsilon naught, where sigma is charge density of the surface. And it is just Q divided by A. Sigma equals Q over A. All right. How do we work out this problem? So we know the electric field in there. We'd like to know a little bit more about voltage, and we'd like to know a little bit more about capacitance. So capacitance is one of these things that maybe you've heard in the past. Let's talk about the capacitance of a parallel plate capacitor. So capacitance is written with a capital C. Unfortunately, right, we've run out of letters, and so we have to recycle these things. But you know, that's good for the earth, recycling. Capacitance C is the following. It's Q over V. Q is a measure of charge. V is a measure of voltage. And a charge over voltage in SI units is something called a farad. It's also the same as a coulomb per volt. Okay, so these are all units over here. One farad is one coulomb per volt. So when you go to the Radio Shack and you say, I need a capacitor, they'll say, what's the capacitance that you want? And it'll be like 10 picofarads or 10 microfarads. Capacitance sounds a lot like capacity. Right? Sounds a lot like that, right? Capacity to do what? Well, it's capacity to store charge. That's what a capacitor is. It's the ability to store charge. Why might you want to do that? Because charge is what powers all sorts of electronic circuits. Right? In your smartphone, you have tons of capacitors. And they don't look exactly like the parallel plate capacitor, of course. But this is a great approximation. Parallel plate capacitor stores charge. If I put a whole bunch of charge there, a whole bunch of charge there, I can store that charge. Okay, let's go back to the question 1740 and see if we know enough now to answer it. Maybe we do, maybe we don't. It says an electric field of 8.5 times 10 to the 5 volts per meter is desired between two parallel plates, each of area 45 square centimeters and separated by 2.4 millimeters of air. What charge must be on each plate? All right, we need to probably talk just a little bit more before we answer that question. So let's do the following. Let's draw our parallel plate capacitor again. We'll draw the cross-sectional view, not the 3D view. And let's do it like this. I have positives on the left, I have negatives on the right. There is therefore an electric field that is pointing from the positive to the negative. If I put a charge in there and it moves a distance, let's call it delta S, charge Q, what is, and let's call it Q naught, that's our test charge, what is the work that is done on it? Work W equals force times distance times the cosine of theta. Everything's in the same direction here, so it's just going to be force times distance, cosine of 0 degrees, just force times distance. The force on charge Q naught is Q naught times E. The distance that we're going to go, we said, is delta S. But we know something about potential and these quantities. Potential V is equal to the work over the charge. Specifically, delta V is the work over the charge. And so we get Q naught E delta S divided by Q naught. The Q naughts drop out, and we get delta V equals E delta S. Good. This one has a high potential. This one has a low potential. The magnitude of the potential difference between those two is just E delta S. Don't worry about whether this should be a plus or a minus. Go back to your picture to figure out which one should be which. All right, it seems like we might almost have what we need, but we need to remember what E is for the parallel plate capacitor. And what we said was E for the parallel plate capacitor is really Q, which is Q on the plates, plus Q on that one, minus Q on that one, Q times delta S And then we had an epsilon naught A in the bottom. Okay, we just plugged in E for the parallel plate capacitor. All right, let's write that up here. Delta V equals Q delta S over epsilon naught A. And I think maybe now we have everything we need. We can also write this as E delta S. So the problem, 1740, says the following. It says, let E have a strength of 8.5 times 10 to the 5 volts per meter. It's desired between two parallel plates, each of area 45 square centimeters. And it's separated by 2.45 millimeters of air. That's going to be our delta S. 2.45 millimeters. And they want to know what charge must be on each plate. Let's see. We know E. We know A. We know delta S. And we are looking for Q. So in this problem, we don't really care about delta V. What we do care about is the other stuff. E was Q over epsilon naught times A. So it almost looks like we don't even need the delta S. Okay? All right, let's put in some numbers and see what we get. We've got Q that we want to solve for. So if I multiply across by epsilon naught times A times electric field, now I can plug in all those numbers. Epsilon naught is the permittivity of free space. That's 8.85 times 10 to the minus 12 in SI units. Area is 45 square centimeters. But centimeters is, of course, not SI units, so we have to convert to square meters. And the way you convert is you multiply by 1. And if I put 100 centimeters down in the denominator, and I put a meter in the numerator, that's the number 1. But of course, I have to square the whole thing. And then I've got E, which is already in SI units, 8.5 times 10 to the 5 volts per meter. And that should do it. We can run these numbers and see what we get. And I'll approximate it here if you guys want to punch it in your calculator. So let's see what we got. We got, this is a 9, that's a 45, that's another 9 roughly, and then we've got a 10 to the minus 12, and we've got a 10 to the 5, and down in the bottom we've got a 100 squared, which is a 10 to the 4. So, let's see. 9 times 9 is 81. 80 times 50 is 400. 4,000, sorry. So that we get a 4 times 10 to the 3 up there. And then we've got a 10 to the minus 12 and a 10 to the 5. So that's a 10 to the minus 7. We're going to divide by a 10 to the 4. And so I'm going to say that Q has got to be approximately 4 times 10 to the, I get a minus 4 up there, I have a 4 right there, and so that's going to be a 10 to the minus 8. Units are coulombs. Did anybody punch in your calculator and tell me how far off I am?
I got 3.4 times 10 to the
8. Okay, so we were off a little bit. 3.4 times 10 to the minus 8. Is that what you got?
Yeah.
Coulombs. Does anybody else concur on that number?
Yeah.
That's what you got? All right, should we punch it in and see if we're right? Do the big test? Let's see. 3.4. I don't know if I'm going to be able to do this here, actually. Nah, it won't let me do it. Unless I'm missing something. Does this keyboard need to be live or something? No, it worked before. Okay, well, let's not worry about it here. You can try it on yours with my numbers and see if you get the same thing. I'm pretty sure that's right. Your numbers will obviously be different. Okay, question about that problem. Any issues with that one, other than the technical issues that we're having? Everybody good? Okay, any more comments from Austin out there? Austin, you still alive and paying attention? All right, let's talk about something relevant to your everyday life, which is the following. Let's say I take a piece of metal. And I take another piece of metal that are shaped kind of like that. And I house them in a big piece of ceramic. And now I charge up these pieces of metal, okay? And I'm gonna put a whole bunch of negative charge on this piece, and I'm gonna put a whole bunch of positive charge on this piece. Okay, and this is some sort of ceramic can that is holding them so it doesn't conduct any electricity. It's an insulator, ceramic. And these things are both metal. So, I got this funky looking piece of metal here. I've got another piece coming out. And I've got a whole bunch of positive charge on this one and a whole bunch of negative charge on that one. Is there an electric field in this region between the two? Sure. Electric fields leave positive charges and go to negative charges. Okay. And if we think about the electric field in there, let's say the following. Let's say that the electric field E has a strength of 2.8 times 10 to the 6 volts per meter. And let's say that the gap distance here, D, is 0.75 millimeters. Let's calculate what delta V is required to generate those fields. All right, how do we do it? Well, we go back to our relationship for E. E was negative delta V divided by the distance D. And so delta V is going to be negative E times D. And I have those numbers, right? E, we said, is 2.8 times 10 to the 6 volts per meter. D is 0.75, and it's millimeters, so we have a times 10 to the minus 3 meters. The meters cancel out, and we're going to end up with volts. And I've already run these numbers, so I'll just tell you what we get. We get 2.1 times 10 to the 3 volts, which is 2.1 kilovolts. That seems like a pretty big number, right? 2100 volts. When you think about volts, and you think about voltages that you're used to, you can talk about the voltage of a AA battery. It's 1.5 volts. A 9-volt battery is obviously 9 volts. Your wall plug coming out of the wall has an RMS voltage of about 115 volts. And now we're talking about 2100 volts. So that seems like a lot, and it seems a little dangerous. And yet, this sort of device you are all extremely familiar with, and you just don't know it yet. What is this thing that I just drew? Does anybody out there know? Or anybody watching know? What is this device that I just drew? Any thoughts? Catherine, what do you think? Okay. I can guarantee. Okay. That's a good guess. A water heater, right? Maybe if we put some water in there, we could do something with it. That's a very good guess. I can guarantee you that you have come across this thing, certainly in your lifetime. Likely today, you were very near this device at some point today, and you likely will be near this device again on your way home today, because this is a device that's where? In your car. This is something that is in your car. Let me draw it slightly differently, and we'll see if you can guess what it is. Okay, that ceramic piece is actually shaped a little bit differently. There are some threads up here, and then the ceramic comes down like this. And then there's an electrode coming out the bottom. Not quite to scale, but that's a little bit better. Anybody know what this device is? Something in your car. What is it? It is a spark plug. Okay, it's not the best drawing. Maybe that's why you couldn't guess it. Okay, but this is a spark plug. This is the ceramic part of the spark plug. It's sort of a white material. And then it has these two electrodes that are coming out the end. There's a center cylinder, and then there's an outer sort of bent piece of metal that comes up like that. And there's a very small gap, right? This is the gap distance, D, which is 0.75 millimeters. And the whole point of the spark plug is to do what? It's to make a spark. If you can generate enough electric field in between those two electrodes, it will in fact generate a little spark. Just like we talked about when you're walking across the floor, the carpet, and you touch the doorknob and you shock yourself, if you do it in the dark, you will see a little tiny spark right there. And the reason that happens is the electric field gets so strong that it starts to pull electrons off of other atoms and molecules that are floating around. And so in a spark plug, there is a combination of gas and oxygen. And when you apply this electric field, and the electric field is high enough, it creates a little spark. And it ignites that fuel-air mixture and creates a little mini explosion right there. And that explosion rapidly expands the gas, pushes down on the piston, attaches to the rest of the crankshaft and so forth to drive your vehicle. And so there's a little piston that goes up and down, and every time it comes up, the spark plug fires off. Okay. Now, to do that, you have to apply a voltage to those electrodes. And it turns out that voltage is pretty big. Right? That's pretty big voltage. What's the voltage of the battery in your car? It's 12 volts, right? That big old honking battery in the front of your car, it's only 12 volts. So there's something else in the car that takes that 12 volts and generates kilovolts out of it, and that's called your distributor. And the distributor ramps up that 12 volt voltage all the way to thousands of volts, and that creates a spark. And this is why when you're working on your car, you don't want to just grab onto the spark plug cables and turn on the engine. That's not a good thing to do, because there are thousands of volts in those cables. Okay? And you likely won't kill yourself, but you could certainly hurt yourself a lot. Okay? So when you're working on your car, make sure that the spark plug and the cable is grounded. And you'll see this sometimes. When people test out the spark plug, they will pull out the spark plug with the cable attached, and then they'll ground it to the car. That means connecting this metal electrode to the car, and therefore when you turn on the car, it will go back into the ground system of the car. It won't shock you. And then you can see if the spark plug's working. And literally you can look down there and just see a little spark go boop, 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 boop. It's kind of cool. ¶¶